Now, only the Lord can speak with certitude concerning everyone or he that or whosoever or all that or any man or that man or every man. See, those are such expressions men can't use those with complete accuracy and confidence. Their expressions include every person falling in the category that's mentioned and excluding everyone that doesn't. And very rarely are we able to speak with that kind of certainty. As an example, in the Gospels, the expression everyone is mentioned 24 times. He that, as mentioned 163 times. Whosoever, is mentioned 82 times. All that were, 4 times. All that are, 2 times. Any man, 43 times. And that man, 9 times. And every man, 15 times. See, you got to see this about Jesus, that there's no ambiguity or vagueness when he talks. Amen. He either opens the matter up or hides it, and there's nothing in between. Amen. Jesus did not speak in generalities, which is the mode of the day. See, this is, I don't know if you've picked up on this or not, but in the last 2 or 3 decades, there has been a shift to generality. As a result, it's man-centered. But Jesus never spoke that way. He always spoke with the whole panorama of truth in mind, so that there weren't places where what he said didn't apply and places where it did apply and so forth. It wasn't like that. If Jesus said it, is to be taken as absolute truth. Now, we're told to try the spirits to see whether they are of God, but this doesn't apply to anything Jesus said. You don't test anything Jesus said. You don't try anything Jesus said to see if it's true or not. If he said it, it's true. It's true of anything said by the Holy Spirit. Anything the Holy Spirit moves someone to say, you never question it. So when people wonder whether a word from God is true or not, see, this is not right. Now I see what I call the peculiar prerogative of faith to accept what Jesus says as it said without trying to shape it or delete something from it or add something to it. Faith can take it just as it is. In fact, faith leans on the word, words of Jesus. It depends on it being true. And Satan, on the other hand, tries to cloud things so that what you see may not be true at all as compared to what you hear. Like Eve, after a confrontation with Satan, she saw the tree was good for food. She saw it was pleasant to the eyes. She saw that it was desired to make one wise. But what she saw wasn't right.
That's right.
She didn't see correctly.
Amen.
See?
Amen.
What God said was
right.
True.
Yes. Yeah.
The result of misjudgment perfectly depicts the consistent result of proceeding in life as though Jesus didn't say anything. See, there are some people that proceed in life just as though Jesus didn't address how they're living.
Yeah.
But this is terrible for the person who so lives. Of course, some people don't know what Jesus said, so your first assignment in life is to find out what Jesus said.
Yeah.
And accept it. Now, what Jesus said is not the same class of like the dietary rules delivered by Moses. It's not it's not in that category, the same category as feast days and things. It's not in that category. Those things were to be observed, understand. What Jesus said is higher up,
amen,
higher than that. I don't believe we can emphasize this too much because we're living in times that are what we might call libertine, a libertine period of Western culture. When people are free to do anything just because they want to, that's reason enough to do it, see?
Yeah. Yeah.
If you like it and you want to, that's reason enough. And people live like this. If they want to do it, they just do it. And that's,
yeah. Uh-huh. Yes.
We're talking largely about unlawful matters. In the midst of a society like that, Jesus' words are arresting. See, he doesn't cater to man at all.
Yeah.
He just makes these statements, and they're like hammer blows to the hard-hearted. They're like a great comfort to the tender-hearted.
Yeah, amen.
Amen.
So let's look at this text, John 3, 20-21. Jesus speaking, still talking to Nicodemus. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. Now let's establish, first of all, there are no exceptions to this word. There isn't anybody ever has lived, ever will live, there isn't anybody that does evil that comes to the light. Yeah, that explains a lot of things right there. That explains a lot of things right there. And there isn't anybody that does truth that doesn't come to the light.
That's right.
Amen. So let's explore this. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light. I want to fast for a moment of this word for. Almost every version omits it, but it is in the text. It's the Greek word gar, and it is in all the Greek texts. I have five Greek texts, and it's all in all of them. For. Let me give you the definition of the lexical definition of for. It means a conjunction which, according to its composition and equivalent, is properly a particle of affirmation and conclusion, denoting truly, therefore, verily, as the case stands. In other words, this is an explanation of the previous statement.
Yeah.
This is the condemnation that light has come into the world, and men loved darkness rather than light. This is he's going to tell you why it's that way. Because their deeds are evil. He's going to explain this, why. The truth of the matter is that there's an underlying cause for everything men do. Mm-hmm. Some of them are more apparent than others, but there's a cause. Man is made this way. Man is not made to live like an animal by instinct. He's in the image of God. He's not made to live that way. Some men try and live that way, but that's not how men were made to live. If a person doesn't see this, there's an underlying cause to everything men do, he will be able to explain deeds. He will not be able to explain deeds, and then he'll always take a neutral position because he's not sure whether it's right or whether it's wrong. Not sure whether the person did it because he wanted to or because he was forced to. See, so they have to take a neutral position so they don't have to make a judgment. That's the reason for neutrality. The reason for neutrality is twofold. One, you just don't want them, you don't want to make a choice. And the other is you can't see any difference, essential difference. Everyone, some of the versions say all or everybody or every, anyone, people who. There's no exceptions to this rule. Everyone, and what he's going to say, it's a description for everyone in this class. This isn't just a mere theological position. This is an announcement of reality, the way it is. And you can adjust your life with this in mind. Everybody. He narrows it down to the individuals. He's not talking about just a class. Everyone. See, it narrows it down to the individual level. Uh-huh. It's possible to get lost in the masses. They have a class of people, but everyone in that doesn't necessarily fit into that class. But so that's not what he's talking about. He goes down to the ground level, uh-huh. the individual level. He says, everyone that does evil. Some versions say practice evil. That's not a good translation. It's not what it means. Even though the lexicon says that is, but that's like a Greek philosophical definition of it. It's not what it means here, practicing. Mm-hmm. Practicing is deliberate. Mm-hmm. And it's continual. And the world calls it habit. That's not what he's talking about here. Here's some of the different versions. Practicing evil, who do evil, whose acts are evil, who do wicked things, practices wicked things, so forth. Everyone who does evil. Yeah. Is Jesus saying those who do evil continually? Is that what? Or does he mean everyone that does evil? Yeah. Which one is it? If you say it's continually, so that mitigates the whole sentence. Yeah. Uh-huh. It's how often? Well, not as often as, uh-huh. it's not all the time, but see, that mitigates the sentence right away. Yeah. Even though an unlearned person could use a Greek lexicon and come up with a practice. That's not what he's saying here. If it's talking about practicing continually. Now, what do you do with Adam and Eve? They committed one sin, and it was evil. See, what do you do with them? Why can't you judge them that way? Huh? Why can't you say they didn't practice sin? They just, see, this is not the scriptural view of things. That's why. And what would you do with Moses who struck the rock? Did Moses practice evil? Mm-hmm. He certainly did not.
That's right. Yeah.
But he did evil here.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
See? So I'm showing you this definition is not right. Uh-huh. What about David and Bathsheba? Did David practice? You can maybe come up with three or four things that could be called sin in a lifetime. Mm-hmm. Not bad.
Yeah.
Or Uzzah. Who touched the Ark of the Covenant? Was he in the practice of doing evil? No, this is just one.
Yeah.
One deed. And can a man really sin when he's in the light? Is that a possibility? That he can sin while he's in the light? I'm saying that whoever sins, however many times he sins, however frequently he sins, he sinned because he did not come to the light.
Amen.
No person first goes to the throne of grace before he sins. Because if he did, he wouldn't have done it.
So he
means exactly what he says. Whoever does evil, he does not want to come to the light.
Yes.
He'll kill the desire to come to the light. He'll squinch it. He'll quench the spirit.
Yeah.
He'll refuse to do it.
Right.
And this goes down to a pretty minuscule level, as I can tell you by personal experience. This goes down to a personal level you don't need to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
But most people will know what I'm talking about.
Right.
That every time there's a temptation to sin, there's some, particularly for a child of God, and even in the world, I think, there's a force that's saying, don't do that.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Amen.
That's right.
There's a way of escape.
That's right.
But nobody who sins looks for it.
Uh-huh. Yes. Amen.
See? He that does evil. hates the light.
Yeah.
Not hates the light every day of his life, hates the light at that time.
That's right. Yeah.
He hates the light.
Uh-huh.
If you will flee to the light, as often as you do that, it will keep you from sin.
Amen.
Now, all of us will admit that we've not had a perfect record here. Mm-hmm. But it's important to admit why we don't.
Yes, amen.
At some point, we say, well, I don't want to think about that right now. I know I shouldn't do this, but I'm going to put this off. I'll come back later. Jesus is going right down to the root of the matter.
Amen.
He hates the light.
Yeah.
The word hate means to detest by comparison.
That's right.
He doesn't detest the light just because it's light. He detests it because the light is counter to the deed he's going to do. The deeds would be reproved if he came to the light, and he knows it. So he doesn't come to the light. Sometimes God is working with people, but they turn off their hearing. They don't pay attention. So Jesus just calls it what it is.
Yeah.
It's hating the light.
Yes,
that by way of comparison, he doesn't prefer the light. In this situation, I don't prefer the light. This is what I want to do. I'll feel better if I do it. I've always wanted to do it. Yes, I know it's not right technically, but it's not going to really hurt anybody. See?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
That's hating the light.
That's right. Amen.
Sin, whether continual sin or committing a single sin, is never preceded by coming to the light.
Yes, amen.
And sometimes you just have to shell down the corn and admit that's the way it was. I didn't come to the light, see? We confess this now with shamefacedness, but we can be forgiven of it. I understand that. We're not talking about forgiveness here. We're not talking about recovery here. We're talking about not doing the thing. This light's available to everybody. Anybody wants to get into this light can get into it. Christ has made a way for them to get into it. The accompanying route of escape is attached to every temptation. If you step into the light, you'll see that way. You'll see that way out.
Amen.
If you don't step into the light, you won't see the way out. Now, the world says, he adopted the phrase, the devil made me do it, you know. But that's not the case.
Yeah, Brother Given, this is a great confirmation, both of your faith and of the fact that you're still in a body that lusts to envy.
That's right.
Because you've already said this, but this is a good confirmation that you know you've had times when this light tried to shine. It tried to lead you to not do it, but you quenched it. You quenched the spirit in order to do it.
I know.
But what a confirmation it is that if you can acknowledge this, if you can see it, now you the work can get done. Now
Amen.
You can start to make progress. But as long as a man will say, yeah, but this is this, you'll
That's
never
right.
understand this.
This is really the way it is.
Yeah.
And I say you can get down to some pretty small, and some of might say small thing, small and personal. They're not the type of things you broadcast.
Uh-huh.
But you know yourself.
Yes, amen.
You know that you kind of sensed the Lord say, "Don't, don't do that. Say no to that.
Yeah.
Say no to it."
Amen.
See, but if a person isn't kept under their body, see,
uh-huh.
brought it into subjection, it just breaks out. The body
That's
just
right.
takes over. And then he tells you why they don't come to the light. That's the ones that do evil, not the ones that are tempted to do evil. Not them. We're not talking about them.
Yeah.
Talking about those that do it.
Yeah. Right.
They don't come to the light lest their deeds should be made manifest. See, they know.
Mm-hmm.
Even people that aren't in Christ know. If they expose themselves to what God said or the Bible or anything, they know what the verdict's going to be already. They know.
Yeah, right.
They might object and say, no, you don't have a right to condemn me. They may have all their arguments, but see, they know.
Yeah.
The reason they don't come to the light,
mm-hmm.
as deliberately step into the light,
uh-huh.
is because they know their deeds will be reproved or exposed.
Yeah.
See, they're going to be exposed ultimately anyway. You just as well as better be exposed here. And stop the thing at the fountainhead. Well, I think this needs to be said a lot because of the approach that people take to sin. They sin more than normal is not the right word, but they sin more than they need to.
Oh, yes. Amen.
Because they don't come to the light soon enough. See, they live way off out in the west fields, you know. They're way off at a distance from God, way off at a distance from the light. So here the crisis arises. They're so far away. They know if they ever did come, they'd be reproved. So they choose to neglect the truth in favor of doing evil. They know it's evil. They know it's wrong. They know they shouldn't do it, but they do it anyway. Then they may be sensitive. Well, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to. No.
Right.
They did mean to do it. That's why they did it.
Amen.
Yeah. We say that to be polite and so forth, but speaking for myself, I don't do anything I don't mean to do.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
It's shameful.
Yeah.
It's reproof now. You come to God with a red face.
Yeah.
But you got to admit the truth.
That's right.
That's the way God made men. He made men this way.
Uh-huh.
Even Satan can't make you do anything unless he makes you want to do it.
Uh-huh. Yes. Amen.
That's his temptation, is an effort to make you want to do it, because he knows you're not going to do it if you don't want to do it.
Yes. Amen. That's right.
What I'm saying is, if you come into the light, you won't want to do it.
Yeah. Amen.
That's a piece of good news.
Yes.
If people can see sin like it really is, they'll avoid it. If they can see Jesus as he really is, they'll come to him.
Yes.
See, that's the way it is.
Yes.
The purpose now, one of the purposes of the church is to make Jesus plain and make sin plain so people know what they're coming to and what they're not coming to, and make it clear what it is, then commend them to God, to the word of his grace, so that they're, what they know will be followed. All right, that's he that doeth evil. It's interesting the way he says it, doesn't he? He didn't say sins, it's he that doeth evil.
Yeah.
Evil, like a fruit that's 100% rotten.
Yeah.
Nothing can be salvaged. Total evil. But he that doeth truth, oh, we're going to have a little contrast here. But... But, and that's like the word for. It's there for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
This is reasoning talk.
Yeah, that's right.
This is logic talk. Mm-hmm. See? So most of the versions omit these words. That's why people, they don't catch the drift of Scripture, because these key phrases that carry the thought out or compare it to another thought or show how one thing is superior to another, they omit all those kind of words.
Yeah.
Even though they're there.
Yeah.
Because this is teaching people how to think. And how to reason. But that is compared to the one who does evil, compared to him, he that doeth truth comes to the light. But that's what we call a word of opposition and distinction. Keep that other, him that doeth evil, keep that person in your mind now. He that does evil. Now I'm going to lay someone else alongside.
Yeah.
That's not like that.
Yep.
So this over here is not a description of everybody.
Mm-hmm.
It's a description of a certain class of people.
Yeah, amen.
Here's another class of people. He that does truth. A manner, this, as I mentioned, is the manner of reasoning where the Spirit fixes the truth more firmly in your mind.
Mm-hmm.
He uses language. Is what you reason with language. You don't. You can't reason with symbols or gestures. So you reason with words, and these words are like nailing this thing into your conscience, so you see it more clearly. We recall more easily things you can comprehend. If you can comprehend it, you can bring it back to memory. If you don't comprehend it, it will kind of elude you. You won't think of it very often. That's why it was important to the apostles and to Jesus, to the holy men of God, that people knew what they were talking about. understood it, because then after the teacher left, they could cogitate on it, see, ruminate on it. But if you don't understand it, it's hard to, you can bring it up and make an additional effort to understand it, but when you understand it, then now you can weave that into the fabric of life. Now this becomes a part of your regular thinking. He that doeth truth. Other versions, some say practice the truth, live by the truth, do what is true, so forth. Those who do the truth, interesting phrase. Do, see, normally we'd say they believe the truth.
It doesn't say search for the truth. Like our generation thinks one of the highest ideals is search for truth. And of course, truth is always debatable.
That's right.
They don't really believe that there's any truth.
Yeah.
Except what everybody votes about for the moment or something like that.
I like that. Do the truth.
That's right. I like that.
Just the way it says it's challenging, see? You got to step back and think about that for a while. Do the truth. See, people, they like to ask, what do you believe?
Yeah.
Right? It's better to ask, what do you do?
Yeah.
Tell me how you live. Yeah. Why you live, what you do when you live. See, that's more potent than what do you believe. Because people believe a lot of things they say that is not woven into their life at all.
Yeah,
it's just a philosophy, that's all. Those who do the truth, eventually, these are the people Jesus shepherds.
Yes. Amen.
If you look at it from the ultimate ultimate sense. These are the people Jesus will teach, those who do the truth. These are the people he has taught and he will teach. Now let's look at it this way. This, the do the truth, this is before Jesus died, before the new covenant. So he's speaking about a condition where a person wants to do what's right. He's not speaking about the truth as it is in Christ Jesus at this point here. It's a person like Nathaniel, in whom is no guile. Mm-hmm. He's right up front about how he's living. Jesus described him as a man who had no guile. He hadn't believed in Jesus at that point, right? He didn't believe in Jesus at that point, but he had no guile. He was doing truth. He was living circumspectly, wanting to do what's right. David also spoke of a man in whose spirit is no guile.
Yeah.
See? Long time before Christ. Mm-hmm. In an even more advanced way, Paul spoke of this manner of himself and the truth. For our rejoicing is this, the testimony of our conscience, that in simplicity and godly sincerity, not with fleshly wisdom, but by the grace of God, we've had our conversation in the world, and more abundantly to you, word. This is, he's speaking of his life in Christ, but this is the kind of thing he's doing truth is about. He described himself also prior to being in Christ. He was doing the truth back then. In all good conscience before God, he says, that's how he lived. See, that's what he's taught. This is what he's talking about. It says doing the truth. It says you're living truthfully, not trying to make an impression, not with a veneer. Actually wanted to do what's right. You may not have all the facts, but you're bent in this direction. Cornelius, he wasn't in Christ. We don't even know if he knew about Christ. But he is described as a devout man, one that feared God. See, he was doing the truth. So a person who is doing the truth isn't living to impress people. They don't misrepresent themselves, try and appear to be something they're not. Now, this is not enough to justify a person. Now, understand, we're not talking about what it takes to justify a person. We're talking about a person who comes to the light. It's a person who's making an effort to do what's right. That's why people in the bars aren't coming to Christ. Huh? I started out when I was a young man. That's the kind of people I worked with. Oh, boy, it was a hard thing to work with because these people could care less about truth. Once in a while you might find somebody in there, but... They weren't seeking to live right.
That's right.
That's why you had to send somebody in to stick the truth before them. That's why they weren't seeking to do what was right. He that does truth comes.
That's right.
Amen.
You don't have to come to him. He comes to you. The tendency of religious men, as I said, is to philosophize about the truth. There have been non-Christian people who called for the truth to be preached to them. Take, for instance, Sergius Paulus, a deputy of the Isle of Paphos. He was a prudent man who called for Barnabas and Saul and desired to hear the word of God. In the sense of our text, he was doing the truth.
Yeah.
See? He was that kind of person. The Philippian jailer. He was that kind of person. Earthquake happened in his jail. He'd heard the prisoners singing. He called for them.
Amen.
He got a light, sprang in and said, "What must I do to be saved?" See, that man was doing the truth. Same was true of Samaria and the Ethiopian eunuch that listened to Philip. Philip goes down there and preaches. The whole city believes. See, they were doing the truth. That's why they believed. Ethiopian eunuch, he was doing the truth. So he believes. He comes to the light. There was no barrier. See, a person who's living truthfully, without guile, without making an attempt to impress people, is more open to the light. He'll come to the light.
Zacchaeus.
Came to the
light.
That's right.
See, they want to do what's right.
Yeah.
Some of them just they don't know what, but they'll come to the light so their deeds can be made. They want to know, am I doing right or not?
Yeah.
Am I pleasing God or not?
They're searching for the light.
That's right. See, they're out there.
The woman that wept on Jesus' feet.
Same thing.
Yes.
See, they're over and over you find instances of this. These publicans and harlots that came to the wedding feast to see Jesus. See, they weren't satisfied with what they were.
Yeah.
But if you just judge by appearance, see, you couldn't tell. Men who tend to argue religion, as I said, will say, "Oh, what do you believe?" What? I'm more and more convinced that's the wrong question. How do you live? Tell me why you live the way you do. And some people will just come right out and tell you.
Yeah.
And you'll be able to work with them. Come up to the light. That is when light's beamed into their area. If it's John the Baptist, they go out to hear him.
Yeah.
If it's Jesus, they go out to hear him. If it's Peter down there, they go out to hear him. See, this is the way it is. If it's Philip, they go out to hear him. They come to the light. When light's beamed into that area, they've got to get to it. This is what happened the day of Pentecost. They heard something was going on. They came to the light. See?
They were devout men.
That's right, devout men. They came to the light. As soon as they heard, as soon as they knew something was going on that was above the norm. Same thing at the temple court where they healed the lame man. The people flocked into the temple court when they healed the lame man. And why do they come to the light? They come to the light that... In order that, not just to satisfy curiosity, that's not why they come. Cornelius didn't call for Peter because he was curious. He'd been told, he'll tell you words whereby you must be saved. Hey, Cornelius was interested in being saved.
Yeah, amen.
He said, "We have come to hear everything the Lord has commanded
that's
you
right.
to tell us."
He came to the light, see?
Yeah.
But what about if you've, what about if you're in a church system that never thinks this way? So you're really not looking for people that are interested. You try and find the worst people possible. See, I question if this is a proper way to go about it. Seems to me like you'd want to convert the people that were more easily converted first. Get them with you. But that's not the way the world thinks. He comes, a person who's doing truth now, he's living honestly, no guile, good conscience, wanting to do what's right. He wants his deeds to be made known. He wants to know if he's doing right. He wants to know if he's doing wrong. If you were sitting under the Pharisees, you know, they misinformed you. And I think people who really were doing the truth, they kind of must, they must have sensed we got to have more than what the Pharisees are telling us here. That's why Jesus was so refreshing. He didn't speak as the scribes. So refreshing to them. You remember, Paul ran across these disciples at Ephesus. They were doing the truth. They did everything they knew was right. Amen. And along comes Paul, and he says, "Have you received the Holy Spirit since you believed?" Oh, they hadn't heard anything like this, but they didn't say, "Well, we don't believe that kind of stuff."
That's right.
See? They were doing the truth.
Yeah.
See? They said, "We haven't even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." All, evidently, all they knew about was evil spirits. So Paul, they came to the light.
That's right.
Yeah. And so Paul informed them. Mm-hmm. They were baptized and went on their way rejoicing. Same on the day of Pentecost. The people that came there, they cried out, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" That was the cry of people that were doing the truth.
Yeah.
Even though not too much before that, many of these people had called for Christ to be killed. Mm-hmm. But they thought they were doing right then,
yeah,
too.
Uh-huh.
Now all of a sudden Peter speaks and they say, "Woo, we weren't doing the right thing." See, their deeds were made manifest.
That's right.
We weren't doing, woo, we weren't doing the right thing at all.
Yeah.
We thought we were, but we weren't. What shall we do? See?
Yeah, that's right.
They came to the light.
Right.
That to me is a wonderful thing. That you can be sensitive to this. Sometimes you'll pick up on a certain people, you'll say, you know, they're being real honest with me. They're kind of above board. They don't have guile.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's all right now. Show them the light.
Mm-hmm.
Show them the light.
Amen.
See, it's the kind of person you want to show.
I noticed that this is the manner in which you took with Brother John Gibbs during that debate. Over and over, you accentuated the fact that you noticed his honesty. And but see, this was allowing him to make some progress.
Yeah, that's right.
See, it was leading him in the right direction, and because these kind of things should be acknowledged.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're rare,
uh-huh.
And they are precious. Person would be morally maybe at the bottom of the pit, or religiously maybe just all confused, but if you can see through all of that.
Yeah.
The person really wants,
yes.
He really wants to do what's right. He's not being like stubborn and hard-hearted. That's not.
Uh-huh.
If he appears to be that way, he's probably been disappointed so many times. See.
Yeah.
Well, he comes that the deeds might be made manifest, but see, it's just not that he wants to know whether it's wrong or not.
Uh-huh.
He wants to know whether they've been wrought in God or not. He wants to know, has God been working in me or not? They've been wrought in God.
Yes, amen.
Or have been done through God, one version says. Have been done by the help of God in various. Now, if we'll talk first about before Christ died. Before Christ died, people like this were described by Solomon. In Proverbs 16:1, the preparations of the heart and man. Now the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. See? The fact that they wanted to do what's right, the devil didn't put that in their heart.
Right. Amen.
Huh? Yeah. The fact they wanted to please God, wanted to obey Christ, they wanted to, see, they were doing the truth. That's what that's talking about there. They had a conscience toward God. The preparations of the heart.
Mm-hmm.
See, God's been working in people a long time before you come along.
Yes, amen.
When those who do the truth come into the light, it's made known it's God that works in you to will and do of his own good pleasure. See?
Yeah.
they find out why it was there. It wasn't like that you just figured it all out. Maybe you did do a lot of thinking about it. But the thing that turned the tide was God working in you, both to will, to want, and to do.
Amen.
To will, that's doing the truth. Mm-hmm. To do, that's coming to the light. See, he that doeth truth comes to the light. Again, he says in Proverbs 20:24, man's goings are of the Lord. See, Solomon knew this. If a man's walking in the right path, his goings are of the Lord.
Yes,
when those who do the truth come to the light, which is known to them, was made known to them, they find out, well, it is, look, it's God that works in you to will and do of his own good pleasure.
Amen.
Such men come to the light like Simeon came to the temple. Remember when Jesus, he's come to dedicate Jesus? It says he came by the Spirit.
Right? Yes.
This is before Jesus died.
That's right.
He came by the Spirit.
Uh-huh.
Coming to the, when a person is coming to the Lord, when it dawns on him why he came, why he came to the Lord, why he came to the light, he's going to see God did this in me, and his confidence level shoots up.
Amen. Yes.
See how this works? No person is going to continue to live for the Lord who's not sure whether God's worked in him or not.
Amen. That's right.
Now, there's people like this, and maybe we all have at one time been in that category where we weren't sure. But when you became sure, it is the Lord. It's the Lord drew me. I know it now. See, your confidence level is boosted. Now you can be trusted to handle the truth. See, and God did the same thing when a long time before Christ, when Zerubbabel was building the temple. Remember, the preparations of the heart are from the Lord. His deeds were wrought in God. It says of Zerubbabel, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel and the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, the son of Josedek, the high priest, and the spirit of the remnant of the people, and they came and did work in the house of the Lord of hosts, their God. Why'd they come?
Amen.
Their deeds were wrought in God.
Amen.
See, God stirred them up to come.
Yes. Amen.
All right, there's...
Later, Nehemiah was stirred up to rebuild the wall.
That's right. The Lord moved him. That's what the deeds wrought in God. That's what it's talking about. See, there's an approach to reaching people where you try and talk them into it.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
I wouldn't say all of that's unlawful. I'm hesitant to say that. But that's not the best.
Yeah.
The best mode of operation. The best mode of operation is to reason with them.
Yes, amen.
So that they'll want to come.
Yeah.
Amen. You can see that Paul had that experience.
Yes, amen.
They go from city to city, synagogue to synagogue, and they were stubborn. They refused him. A few did.
Yeah.
But it appears that he had the most success in Berea.
That's right.
Where the people
were more noble.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Amen. You can all see this, can't you?
Yeah, amen.
It changes. It'll save you a lot of time.
Yeah, amen.
It'll save you a lot of time. Now, you don't want to be, you don't want to be swift in making judgments who should hear and who shouldn't. You got to be wise in this area. But
what
you're trying to find is someone who wants to come to the light.
Yeah, that's right.
That's what you're targeting.
Uh-huh.
That should be your first premier approach should be to people that want to come to the light. That's how Jesus worked. That's how the apostles worked. It's all through Acts. That's how it was.
Yeah, right.
They didn't spend much time at all with people that turned them down.
Uh-huh.
Cast the seed wide. Just cast the seed out.
That's right.
It'll find good ground.
See, if they see the light, they'll come to the light.
Yes.
You say, and when they see Christ, they'll come to Christ. That's the way it works. If you can make Jesus live, that's done two ways. Through your life, It's got to be evident you're living for Christ.
Amen.
And to the preaching of the gospel. That will induce people to come to the light.
Yes.
But the people who come are the people who are doing truth, that are not, that have no guile.
Uh-huh.
They're not pretentious people. Now, if you've worked for the Lord very long, you can put in your count on one hand the pretentious, fake, hypocritical people that responded to your ministry. That's not the way it works. It didn't work that way for the prophets or for Jesus, but there were people who, when Jesus come, it kindled a fire in them, because they were wanting all along. Maybe the people didn't see it, but all along they were doing the truth. They wanted to do what was right.
Amen.
The Lord's description there in the parable of the sower was the good soil were those with good and honest hearts.
Good and honest hearts.
Those who do the work.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
You can ask the Lord to help you in this.
Yes.
To be very sensitive about this.
Mm-hmm.
I think you'll find that you'll be brought into contact with people that maybe you didn't suspect. That they were people without guile. Like Nathanael, remember when Jesus said, I saw you under the fig tree. He says, how'd you see me under the fig tree? See?
Yeah.
But he actually was glad to hear it when he knew it was the truth. He said, no, he says, I know you're the man whom is no guile. He said, I never met you. How'd you know that? He said, I saw you under the fig tree. He personalized it. And what did Nathanael do? He came to the light.
That's right, yeah.
One of the first ones. Now in Christ, those who do the truth, see, now there, this do the truth, that applies to people before Christ, like Cornelius and people like that. Now let's look at it as Jesus uttering a prophecy about what was going to be. John, he saw people that were doing the truth. Here's what he said to them. 3 John 1:3. I rejoice greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that's in thee, even as thou walkest in the truth.
Mm-hmm.
So what's he going to do? He's going to be able to tell these people more than he could tell other people.
That's right.
They take the truth. What does it mean to do the truth now that you're in Christ? You do the truth.
Uh-huh.
You take the truth. You can translate it into living.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
You can take this truth and you can embed it into the way you live and the way you think and the way you talk.
Mm-hmm.
You can translate it into living. All right, let's take that translate into living. Now let's just see how Paul stated that type of situation in 2 Corinthians 4:10-11. Always bearing about in my body the dying of the Lord Jesus. I bear in my body the dying. Don't miss that. See, you're going to have to display both the death and the life of Christ.
That's right.
Both of them have to be displayed. Bearing in my body the dying of the Lord Jesus. That the life, that in order that the life of Jesus might be made manifest in our body, in our body.
Yeah.
Yes. How's the life of Jesus? How it's going to be manifested in your body? That's what he said.
That's right. Amen.
Yes, if the dying of Jesus is manifested in your body.
Uh-huh.
If they can see you don't really have a dominating interest in this present evil world. They kind of tell. Sometimes they tell the way you speak, the way you, where you go, the way you dress, the way you act. I mean, they can pick up on it. This person is not tied into the world system. That the life of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. That's a weighty.
Because
this people, see, we live in a society that encourages explaining why you blew it. It's like almost like a science. If you muffed it and you made a big blunder, you kind of explain why you did.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
A better way is let the dying of Jesus be manifest in your,
Amen.
In you, so that in your body the living of Jesus,
yes.
So that you will talk like Jesus would talk when you're around people. you would live like Jesus would live, see? That's doing the truth as it is in Christ Jesus. It's taking the death of Christ. It's not proclaiming it just as a historical fact or a key point in theology. You say, look, I'm dying with Jesus. If you're in Christ, the body is dead because of sin. That's a statement of Scripture. So you die with Jesus, and then God works in you the life of Jesus. Jesus said, now if a man walk in the day, that's coming to the light, see? If a man walks in the day, he stumbles not. That's what he said. I know we can say, well, we all make mistakes. Well, that like is not exactly a revelation. You know? You don't like have to be super wise to know that we all need a Savior and we all need to confess our sin. This is not the thing you say. What you say is the grace of God can teach you to say no to these things. I didn't sin because I had to sin. That's not why I did. I could have come to the light. He said, if a man comes to the light, see, that'll abort the committing of sin. That will abort the committing of it. If you don't come to the light, then you'll have to come later and confess and go through that. But that's second best. It's necessary to do that. If you sin, it's necessary to confess your sin. Then he'll forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness so you don't go back and do that thing again. John said this way to Gaius. He wrote this to Gaius. He said, beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. He that doeth good is of God. He that doeth evil has not seen God. those are potent, potent statements. A lot of people say, yeah, but. Yeah. Yeah, but. Wait a minute now. Who's able to say that? Well, the Holy Spirit wanted this said.
Amen.
This is the truth. He that does good is of God. This is good by God's definition. You see, wait a minute. The Scripture says there's none that doeth good, no, not one. That's by nature, not by grace.
Yeah, amen.
This is how the state is before you come into Christ. It's not the state after you're in Christ. After you're in Christ, you do good.
Amen.
That's what you've been born again to do.
That's right. Yeah, but it says here in Hebrews 13:21 that he can make you perfect in every good work. To do his will.
That's right. I understand. We all know that we still need to say, you'll never come to the point where you don't need a Savior you don't need an intercessor.
Amen.
You will not arrive at that. But see, that's not the way this is taught in Scripture.
Right.
Even though every honest person knows it's the case, what's held out before you is the ideal.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Is what's available. There is grace available not to.
That's right.
Whether or not we avail ourselves of it may be another question, but it is there just the same. Yeah.
Well, the only reason it's available is because we have a Savior and an
intercessor.
That's
right.
Yes.
That's why Jesus died, is to make these things pure procurable.
That's right.
Yes.
So you could get them.
Yes.
See? So Jesus, he's speaking to Nicodemus. It's almost like it's out of season. It's before this thing is really going to commence, but it's for our sakes it's been recorded, see?
Yeah. Like the prophet Isaiah said, I tell you about it before it comes to pass.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah, if these things aren't working in someone who has come to Christ, then they have stifled it.
Yeah.
Because God's given us all things, so these things are normal in the kingdom of God.
That's right. And again, I must be careful to say these things aren't given so you can examine other people.
That's right. Yeah.
This is so you can examine yourself.
Amen.
Examine yourself to see if you're in the faith. you can't take these and go about judging everybody because you don't have all the facts. Amen. You all you have is what you can see. You don't know all the facts there. So you're going to have to depend on recognizing whether they want to know the truth or not. If they do, that's a big plus right there. That's a big plus. If they don't want to know the truth, you want to do your best to provide the incentive to know the truth. If they turn it down, you just move on to the next person. God has a big family. It's a big family. No one there when Stephen was stoned, converted to Saul of Tarsus. Sometime later that he was converted, but there was someone in the camp that could be sent to him, because once he saw Jesus, he had changed his whole perspective. And so when Ananias come, Ananias didn't have to hold a crusade. He didn't have to have a series of lessons. What he said one time, because Saul was ready to his deeds to be made manifest. He didn't have to tell Saul, you were sinning and persecuting the church. He didn't have to tell him that. His deeds had already been made manifest by the light of Christ, see?
That's right.
Having our deeds made known that they are done in truth, this is not something that's mystical. It's not like a kind of a feeling that you get. This has to do with your conscience and being aware I'm accepted. In the beloved, I'm accepted. God has made me accepted in the beloved. My conscience, and I think I shared this with you, but I want to share it with you again. There was a particular matter in my life way back, 50, 60 years ago. It had bothered me, and I wasn't sure whether I really had handled it right back then. And it woke me up at night, and it troubled me, and finally I said, look, I'm going to confess this to God. And he cleansed my conscience, and this thing hasn't bothered me since. What did I do? I went to the light.
Yeah, right. Yep.
See? I went to the... See, and it's just the light, the way, he's made a way. A new and a living way. Everybody can get to the light now.
Amen.
Everybody can get to the light now. When you do, your deeds will be made manifest. The particular emphasis is not the wrong ones, although that will happen, but the particular thing was, you're where you are now and stand in this light. I drew you in here. Jesus said, no man can come to me except the Father sent me draw him. Now you can philosophize about that if you want, but here's how it ought to work. If you came to Jesus, the Father drew you.
Amen.
Boy, that's a strong, that's a strong reason. Now Jesus will give you, Jesus said, now if any man comes to me, I'll in no wise cast him out.
Yeah.
So you've got that,
that's right.
You'll have that guarantee.
Amen.
Now part of confirming the souls of the disciples, which is what Paul had a heart for, you know, and him and Barnabas, Peter appeared to have done so much of the same thing, is assuring them that their deeds have been wrought in God.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the big factors. It's not the only one, but it's one of the big factors is to see the hand of God in what they've done.
Amen.
In coming to Christ, in believing on Christ, in confessing Christ. No man can say that Jesus is Lord saved by the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. See, when you see God gave me repentance. See, God gave to me to believe. When you see this, God that's working in me to will and do of his own good pleasure. Assurance wakes up.
That's right.
And you become a very noble fighter when you're confident.
Yes, yes, amen.
You don't do too well if you're not.
Right.
He said to the young Thessalonian church, you know, he was just there 3 weeks, three Sabbath days. We're not sure whether it was every day even. Three Sabbath days, just said, we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. What's he doing? Your deeds were wrought in God. See, that's what he's explaining, that it's very thing to them. To the Galatian church, they'd lost their way, but Paul held out a time. an incentive to them. He said, but now after ye have known God, or rather, are known by God.
Yeah.
The Galatians needed to hear that.
Amen.
They needed to hear that because they weren't doing too good at knowing God. They went back. They'd left him that called him into the grace of Christ.
Yeah.
That's what Paul told them. So what did Paul tell them? He told them back when their works were wrought in God. Yeah. And that would be a powerful incentive to come back. So God does not intend people who don't do the truth to have a sense of divine acceptance. God doesn't intend for that to be. But by the same token, he doesn't intend for people who do the truth not to know they're accepted. And so that's one of the commissions we have, that the people whose hearts are right but whose understanding is deficient, you want to help them to understand you are the work of God. You're his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before ordained you should walk in them. See, some people don't know that. Mm-hmm. That are in Christ, they don't know this. So you inform them of it.
Amen.
That's a little bit of what's in this text, but I it's a very challenging text.
Yes.
You sense that it's a wide open field to commit yourself to this sort of work. Now, any of you have a word you'd like to add? Yes.
It's over the course of this week, I started getting into Exodus at work, and going through the tabernacle, all the stuff that was involved in the tabernacle. It reminds me, right after the sin offering, I had the grain offering. He was the sacrifice for sins. So it's like on the Day of Atonement. Remember, on the Day of Atonement, no work could be done.
Yeah.
On the Day of Atonement, we didn't. There was nothing that we did
that
took away our sin or made us reconciled to God. But afterwards, right after the sin offering, was the grain offering, which it was something that you were personally involved in, and offering that to God. So it's like, this doing the truth and offering yourself to God, it's something that God expects. It follows up with that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Now
this is a powerful incentive to hold out to the saints, to that God is the one that's working in them. I tell you, when that broke through to me, and it was done in the assembly by someone who was ministering, and it hit me, it's God that's working in me. Well, then you can't fail. I mean, now if God's working in you, see, that's seeing it from the heavenly perspective. God doesn't do anything wrong. So if I'm doing something wrong, I'm not following, I'm not listening, I'm not submitting.
Yeah. Come to the light.
But see, this is a great ministry that the saints have.
Yeah.
To point that out to somebody, look, it's God that's working in you. Why? That can do get a lot of stuff done right there.
Yeah, Sister Barbara.
You were speaking about the words of Christ earlier in the introduction here tonight. The words, Christ Himself is the light of the world, and His words make manifest. So I was considering the word of Christ speaking that. Knowing the word of Christ, speaking that to others, that's going to give this light that we were talking about tonight. Several instances where we've had experiences with brethren who are good and honest in their heart, but mm-hmm. lack understanding in certain areas. And when the word of Christ is spoken to them, then they're able to identify the truth, and then they conform themselves to
it.
Mm-hmm. This is one of the things that we're talking about tonight.
Amen.
That the word of Christ has that power.
Amen.
See, your light, your life is a candle.
Yeah.
That draws people to the light. But once they come to the light, somebody's got to open the thing up to them. Yeah.
Since you exposed me to this truth some 20 years ago, what's been a great encouragement and comfort to me is the thought that the things that I've been instructed to do all those years before. They're not totally dependent upon me. But God undergirds a heart fully committed to Him.
Mm-hmm.
He holds that, strengthens that heart. Mm-hmm. It's God at work in you.
Yes.
Both to will and do these things. He makes mm-hmm. these things known. He shows us these things. He draws us to Himself. Mm-hmm. All of these statements, when you begin to think about this, you, as we said before, you see this numerous places in the mm-hmm. Scripture. Maybe not everywhere, but
quite a few places.
But it's yeah. a lot of places. Yeah. You see this, how God is working in His people. And so these things are just the fruit. You
Amen.
Might say the grain offering. Uh-huh. It's the grain offering that we're giving back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now you notice that you can't build an institution on this uh-huh. on this type of thing. Amen. You can't build a human organization. You can't.
Yeah. Right.
It's deliberately structured that way. Jesus, yeah. there's already a building program going on. Jesus is building Amen. His church.
Human earthly things involved yeah. in that.
So you can't. Truth will not assist a person to build an institution yeah. or an organization. Uh-huh. It will only facilitate what God's doing. Yes. Which simplifies things quite a bit because yeah. there's a lot of voices going on out there, you know. Yeah. Anyone else? All right. Your sister?